My name is Jason J. Rock Houston, and tonight I'm speaking with guitar player Bobby Cannon. And Bobby, we're talking to you tonight because you're in a Motorhead tribute band called Motorheader, and you guys are based out of Los Angeles. Is that correct?
No, from San Francisco, actually.
Oh, San Francisco.
Where's calling? Hold on.
Okay, sure.
Hold on.
Okay. Okay, hi Glenn, how are you doing? My name is Jason.
Jason.
Yeah, I'm not sure if Bobby told you, but I'm interviewing you guys tonight about your Motorhead tribute, and I guess you guys are based out of San Francisco. So, how long have you guys been together?
Yeah, Bobby. On and off for maybe a couple years. We did it for a little bit, and then, you know, we all have other projects and original bands and stuff like that, so that put it on hold for a little bit. And since then, we've been settling in with our original bands, and we decided to do this again.
Okay.
So, a couple years.
Yeah, okay, because I've been looking for a Motorhead tribute to kind of talk to, and I kind of did a search on Facebook the other day, and that's how I came across you guys. So has it been a while since you guys have played a gig, or have you been playing a lot more recently?
We just did one. When was it, Glenn? On Saturday?
Yeah, San Francisco. Yeah,
How did the gig go? Did you guys have a lot of people come out and check you out?
Yeah, we were loud.
It was great. It was for the Vampires MC annual Christmas party early.
Oh, cool.
And it turned out really good.
Cool. And now,
quite a bit of people there.
And now let me ask you guys, you like the role Motorhead? You guys are a trio?
Yes.
Okay. And I guess the best place to start this off, Bobby or Glenn, you guys can decide who wants to answer this. How did you guys, first hook up and start doing the Motorhead thing?
We played in bands together, and then I kept losing band members to tribute bands. Can't beat them, join them.
Yeah, and and how did you guys each get into the music of Motorhead? I mean, how did you become Motorhead fans yourselves?
You're talking a long time ago, probably before you were born.
Yeah. but
I've been in them since, 70s, and I've been in them since, 70s or 80s, too.
Yeah.
Actually, our drummer's calling in now, so let me go grab him real quick.
Okay, sure.
When are we going on air?
No, we're not live, so don't worry. This is being recorded, and it's going to be posted at a later date, so that's not going to be a problem.
Oh, so it's not live. It's not like that, you're on the air now, go.
No. So just,
Yeah. So you're gonna use Photoshop and Pro Tools to create an interview, right?
Well, yeah, basically, I don't know if you had a chance to check out the site. That's kind of what we do is, We record the interview, and then we find some, we usually get the photos off of Facebook. Unless there's specific photos you'd like us to use, you could send those in.
Put a photo of a Motorhead up there.
Yeah.
Those guys really look like them.
Yeah, yeah. So, talking about that, okay, so, okay, Scotty, so I guess I'll ask you, Scotty, since I was asking the other guys, how did you first become a fan of Motorhead?
Oh, for me, man, probably when I was about maybe, 10 or 12 years old.
Uh-huh.
My brother had Ace of Spades, and I got a copy of it, and that was right around the time I was, discovering all the new wave of British heavy metal stuff. I was really, into the Scorpions and, Maiden. And, very quickly, my top three bands throughout my whole life became AC/DC, Iron Maiden, and Motorhead. Just, right off the bat, they still are to this day.
And I think, most people admit that Ace of Spades is one of their favorite songs. But you guys ever get tired of playing that?
Yeah, that's the only song we do. We just do it over and over.
Yeah. And on that note, I got to ask you guys, as fans, do you find you're bigger fans of a, you know, the classic like 70s material, or are you as big a fan of the new stuff they've put out recently, like Aftershock?
Well, I mean, obviously, I mean, I think like Metallica, people are like, oh, the old Metallica. You know, yeah. Everybody's kind of, I think if you got into it at that point, like I did, I was into it when it first came out because nobody liked Motorhead. Everybody hated them. Nobody even heard of them.
Yeah.
You had to go to the import and order them from England on bond. They weren't even on American label. So, here's your little secret. This band, oh, man, check these guys out. Because it was looking for the heaviest band possible. It was like the search for the heaviest sound.
Yeah.
And at the time, the only heaviest bands were Judas Priest, another band nobody heard of. They thought it was a religious band. And AC/DC, and I think Van Halen. So we heard of Motorhead. I went over the damn thing. It was like, oh, man, these guys are, you know, the heaviest thing there was. So obviously, they obviously peaked out too. Then that's what their biggest selling albums were, 1980 and 81.
Yeah, and Motorhead, you know, it's kind of an interesting band to, you know, pay tribute to, because while they're a legendary band, you know, Motorhead is one of those bands, like you're saying, people either love them or they hate them. And on top of that, as musicians, I got to ask you, because these songs are like, just to listen to them, they're incredibly fast. I mean, you know, how fast are you guys playing? I mean, that must be a big part of what you do.
Just from a drummer aspect.
Yeah.
I play them probably a little faster. Some of this, we try to keep it as true, especially me, being the new guy. Yeah. I mean, I really want to, you know, keep it as close to Filthy tempos and try to keep that Hammersmith thing going. And I think, you know, and Jenna with Glenn and Bobby is just like, they know that stuff unbelievably well,
The speed metal you listen to.
Yeah, being a little more of like a, probably just a couple of years younger or whatever, but I'm more of like the, you know, I come from a, like, I'm one of the Bay Area rat kids, but when you're Stone and the Omni, and, you know, like you were saying about, like Glenn was saying about Motorhead being, you know, their little secret, by the time I discovered them, you know, they'd already been around. You know, I hit them about the time around Iron Fist or Orgasmatron, but, you know, the Bay Area was like that for me. Like Violence, Testament, those were our bands, and they were our little secret bands. And once they became huge and Headbangers Ball and all that, it was kind of like, man, this sucks, man. Those are like our guys, you know what I mean?
And so,
the Motorhead thing, and kind of, you know, they played stuff to Motorhead. I think probably they had the songs were slower in the studio than when they went live.
Yeah.
They were playing so fast, probably because they were doing some great speed. And then, you know, and then people hear them say, yeah, we gotta play our songs fast, and they say, yeah, Metallica and all these other bands doing cut time, and you know.
Yeah.
And they kind of are credited for starting speed metal, but basically they were just a rock band playing super fast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, my goal is to try to cross somewhere between, you know, Filthy and Mickey D, because Mickey, you know, obviously a huge influence on me. And going back to the original question about, you know, are you a fan of the, you know, earlier stuff or newer stuff, I like it all. I'm a huge fan of all of it, but I especially like, you know, Inferno with Killers. We just started doing that, and I'm a huge fan of that era. And the last album, The World Is Ours, what? I mean, that's the best thing I heard them do in 20 years. It was an incredible record.
Yeah.
I have that one.
Yeah, The World Is Ours, I think.
It's unreal.
The World Is Ours, I think, is two different collections, live collections. But yeah, it's pretty cool because it's such a cross section like throughout their entire career.
Yeah, it's an amazing record. I mean, everything on there is just unreal.
And what I dig,
he's an Orgasmatron guy, aren't you?
Yeah. And what? And what I dig about
we did Dr. Rock off that album. It's kind of hard picking songs. Like, oh, we want to do this one. We want to do that one. We want to do this one.
Yeah, and how hard is that as far as picking a set list? Because, like, Motorhead, like, you know, everyone's yelling, Ace of Spades, you know, Killed by Death, but they're not one of those typical bands that...
We don't play Ace of Spades. We just tell them we can't do that one. Sorry. Yeah. No, you know what's cool about that? You asked the question, too. Do we ever get tired of hearing it or playing it? Absolutely not. That's one of those songs for me that's right there. It's funny. Me and my girlfriend were just talking the other day. Rainbow in the Dark. Never will I get tired of that song. I can hear it 100 times a day. I love it. Ace of Spades, I feel the same way. And it's cool to hear Lemmy talk about it, too. He says, you know what? It's not, you know, they have to play it every show, obviously, but they could have been
long enough.
Well, it's funny to hear everybody wax so topical now about, you know, yeah, what a genius of lyrics, you know. I remember back when people freaking hated Motorhead. The media hated them. Other Shredder, guitar player, hated Motorhead because it was too simple. Singers hated Motorhead because they wasn't going, whoa! You know, I was the only guy that liked them.
Yeah,
Like when we saw Rihanna wearing that Judas Priest shirt on stage, like,
yeah.
You know who Ralph Halford is.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, Motorhead is one of those bands, like we were saying, people either love them or hate them. And the interesting thing is, even here in the States, you know, if you're a diehard Motor fan, you've known about them for years, they're like, you know, the best kept secret, so to speak. They didn't even really break out big time, you know, commercially in the States until, you know, the early 90s. So, it's just amazing, right. You know, and actually, Lemmy's a pretty good songwriter. People fail to realize, besides Motorhead, he actually wrote a lot of those tunes on Ozzy Osbourne's No More Tears album, so, you know.
Exactly. Mama, I'm Coming Home with
Me. Yeah, and so, again, that just shows what a gifted writer is, and he could have probably been a lot more successful writing tunes like that for Motorhead, but one thing you gotta love about Motorhead is they don't necessarily care about you know, having a number one album. They want to put out an album that they're going to love first, and then hopefully their fans will love it.
Yeah, I mean, they're getting a lot of love now, but I tell you, they never didn't get a lot of love before, as I remember.
Yeah.
You were an outcast.
They opened for Ozzy in 81 or 2. People were just like, boo, you know?
Yeah. And so, it must be great being like doing the Motorhead tribute, because like I said again, you know, here in the States, there's not a lot of them. So, you know, have you guys been getting a pretty good response at your shows when people come out?
Yeah, we've had a good response. Nikki, she is one of my really good friends. I've been friends with him for like 30 years. I mean, we're close. He calls me like maybe once a month, every couple weeks, just so we can catch up and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, well aware of us too.
Yeah, that's
really open for him.
Yeah.
I know. We'll play the songs they don't play.
Yeah, we'll put together like their B-side list or something. Yeah. It's an original band that sounds just like Motorhead, you know? That would be better.
Yeah, yeah.
That'd be great.
And so, how often do you guys get together and rehearse? I mean, are you at a point where you're pretty comfortable in your ability to play these songs?
Yeah, the miles of distance between where we live, it'd probably be about 1,500, 2,000 miles, something like that.
Wow, wow.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been to Cedar County. Bobby's in, Bobby's in the Bay Area, and then the drummer's from Sacramento or Modesto or something.
Wow, wow.
Central California.
Wow.
Now, we'll get together like maybe 2 weeks prior to the gig, one, and then the night before the gig.
Okay. And so, So you guys are pretty...
It's kind of a tribute band. You got to know the songs. I mean, you either know or you don't, you know.
That's the thing. You come up on them and you love them and, you know.
It's not like we're playing in a Dream Theater tribute where you have to rehearse every day.
Yeah.
I mean, it is difficult on the drums, that's the thing.
So again, like, how serious are you guys about this? I guess what I'm asking is, is the band your main source of income, or do you have other things you do? Well, that's you guys seem to have a great sense of humor, so I think that's cool.
I mean, you know, for me personally, I mean, you know, like I said, I mean, I have a, you know, a day job and you know, another band that I'm in, and I think, you know, Bobby's out of a couple projects. Glenn's a genius. You got to see this guy, man. I mean, the bass playing is just unbelievable. See his chainsaw sculpture that he does. that's some crazy stuff too.
And so, is this Motorhead tribute you guys do? Is this something you just kind of do for fun right now? Or are you hoping to do a lot more shows with this?
A little of both. I mean, we do it for fun, but you know, we like to do our shows. We kind of like to pick and choose, make sure.
I mean, if you play in a cover band too. It's like, you know, what would you rather, what would you, you want to play your favorite stuff, you know, your favorite band, right? You know, you either play these, three bands I've done since, you know, the original music kind of stuff, people don't really seem to support that much in the club, but the tribute shows get a lot of crowds, so, okay, I played in an AC/DC band, I played in a Judas Priest tribute band, and literally, so those are like my three favorite bands, so what, you know, it's all fun. I mean, hey, it's great, you make some money, it's awesome, pays for the gas and the equipment, abuse, and all that stuff, but no, it's pure fun.
Yeah, and the cool thing about Motorhead is, you know, like I said, for people that are fans, they're really diehards, and so even the real Motorhead hasn't been able to tour as much, you know, over the last year, because Lemmy's been quite ill, but, you know, that's a great thing for a band like you guys. You're kind of keeping the legacy going, and you're saying, you know, one of you guys are telling me, you know, Mickey D, so has he actually seen your band, or have you guys just sent him pictures, or what's he commented on the band?
He hasn't seen the band, but he's like looked at YouTube stuff when it was up. I don't think it's there anymore. It's like band stuff, and I showed him a couple things, and he's really supportive. He really likes it. You know, he thinks it's great.
Yeah, and the cool thing about a guy like
they have the audience still with their other songs besides one of them. Don't I hate to say it, they don't know anything besides Ace of Spades. So you know, we play a lot of stuff off of that album, which is, you know, great album. Some stuff, you know, from the earlier albums, Overkill, Anthist, you know, those albums, which to me, I like the older stuff myself. I mean, it is the original lineup, obviously. So, you know, I'll tease Mickey every once in a while. Look, the Hammer, you don't play that one. Or Hearthstone, you don't play that one. Do about, Juju in the back.
Yeah.
And so, those songs are great grooves, man. Yeah. So, the last show was just Juju in the back, and saw some girls starting to dance. It's like, yeah, they're dancing to a Motorhead song, and it's got a great groove beat, you know?
Yeah, you know, and Motorhead is one of those bands that you could go see, and it kind of amazes you. They can play to almost any crowd. I mean, a lot of people listen to Motorhead are obviously, like, you know, into riding motorcycles or bikers and stuff. But, you know, I've seen all kinds of bands play with Motorhead. It just amazes me.
Right.
And so
Reverend Horton Heat that one time opened up for Motorhead.
Yeah.
That was cool.
Yeah, yeah.
They speak water with Motorhead.
I've seen Clutch with Motorhead, one of the best shows I've ever seen.
Wow. Really?
Yeah.
And so,
it's rock. I mean, right now, there's music that is pretty well, people have no idea what the hell they're like. I mean, everybody's grasping at the past because there's really nothing new. It's all computer music now, right? Everything's being done with a finger and a computer. So, to actually hear a raw song that you can pretty much think that, hey, I could write a song, you know, it's simple, like AC/DC, I bring that band up. Similarity, you know, all the songs, same format, it's rock, and people like it.
Yeah,
and it's rock,
yeah.
Something other than the crap that's out now, you know.
Yeah,
and it's all the manufactured bullshit that's selling all the manufactured music. Yeah.
And you guys make the point that, you know, a lot of people, they listen to Motorhead, they think like AC/DC, it's, you know, it's based on the same three chords, it's simple music, but how hard is it to play that, you know, the Motorhead music? Because again, you know, they're playing at a relatively fast speed. I mean, you got to be able to, you know, keep up with that.
They're not all fast.
Yeah.
No, but the you know, especially the Ace of Spades, Iron Fist era stuff with Phil B. Taylor, he was groundbreaking.
Yeah.
And at that time, listening to, you got to put it in perspective, of that era was the fastest thing I'd ever heard in my life. Just like hearing Angel of Death for the first time from Flair,
right,
was the fastest thing I ever heard in my life. You got to put that in perspective, but at the same time, I mean, the bass playing is unbelievably complicated, and that's why it's like hats off to Glenn for doing it, because a lot of people don't think Lemmy plays bass that well.
Yeah.
They think he just plays it like the guitar. Bullshit.
Yeah.
That guy is a bass playing fool, man. You gotta really, really smack it.
Yeah.
With a pick. It is like, it's like a four-string guitar with giant strings.
Yeah, plus, it's got to be pretty.
I do a Marshall guitar amp and a bass amp together to get that sound. I mean, I in my original bands, I always wanted to do that because I was into that sound way back. And it was a band called The Stranglers that had that sound.
Yeah.
I even remember, you know, what was the big early band that had that real brackish, you know, through a Marshall, kind of a little bit distorted, and you play some chords, and it's just, it sounds mean.
And so Glenn,
Pearson kind of had that sound too from Cheap Trick.
Wow. So Glenn, are you?
Oh yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
So Glenn, are you the one that sings the lead in the band?
Well, I mean, you're you know, let me sing and play bass, and then, you know, pass it on guitar and fill it on drums. Yeah, three piece.
And so
trio.
So I got to ask you, Glenn, how hard is that to, you know, play the bass and sing those songs? Because again, you know, you got to pay attention to what you're singing and also being able to hit the right notes.
I mean, it's like anybody play, you know, anybody that plays guitar and sings, yeah. Any other musician. I mean, we all, like I said, we all got music in bands, and I was a guitar player and singer before, and bass player and singer, so it's not that. I mean, the chords and things and what you're playing on aren't that, you know, there's not a million notes. It's harder if you're having to do something like play Rush and sing or something, you know. It's, for me, it's not that hard. Plus, I know the song, so.
Yeah, and then, Bobby, I'd like to ask you, because you were telling me, besides this band, that you also are in another tribute band, oddly enough, a Duran Duran tribute, which is kind of cool, I think. How different is that? I mean, you know, Motorhead and doing a Duran Duran tribute, I mean, that's kind of like the opposite ends of a spectrum, but that's got to be a pretty cool thing to, you know, do a different type of project
and
like
it's
that.
Just, it's just different types of discipline for each band.
Yeah.
Like more, you know, I got to focus more on, like, changing effects like 12 times in one song.
Yeah.
And singing harmonies and not playing as loud, and you know, it's a keyboard and bass dominant band.
Yeah.
Yeah,
could you imagine? I mean, a double bill like that. But you know, to me, to a guy that's myself, I'm not even a musician. But just knowing that you could do the Duran Duran stuff and the Motorhead thing, again, two totally different ends of the spectrum. But that just speaks volumes about, you know, what it gets.
Yeah,
in
yeah. I started out playing like funk and disco and stuff, and you know, and that's where I started playing. So I learned the whole kind of groove thing with playing behind this guy. And then after when I was like, you know, 11, 12, so I'm getting the UFO album, got some Motorhead albums, and I saw Dan on the Green in 81 with Randy Rose.
Yeah.
Ozzy wasn't even supposed to be there. He came in as a special guest. And that kind of like changed everything after that.
Yeah, and again.
Rose was the last guy on a UFO, so.
Yeah, and again, you know, I want to make the point that I think it's a totally cool thing that you can do Motorhead and Duran Duran, because it just speaks volumes that, you know, you must be that gifted a musician to be able to play, you know, more than one type of music, you know.
A lot of tribute bands have really good musicians there, because, like I said, there's a lot of good original bands, people that I know, that if you get gigs playing original bands, it's easy, but if it's a tribute, there's lots of shows, so there's a lot of really good musicians in tribute bands around, I imagine. That's where they all end up, usually, you know?
Yeah, unless you live in Europe or something where, you know, they're still dominated by heavy metal and hard rock, which is a United States thing. I think just everything's so manufactured, and people only find what they see on American Idol and whatever's forced to fetch it.
Yeah.
I can go to the clock and listen, oh, it's a Rolling Stone tribute, cool. That's cool, I like that. You know, I don't want to hear, you know, Vomit Breath, you know, the local metal band or whatever, you know?
Yeah, and I think it's cool, you know, Bobby, the fact that, like, you can do a Duran Duran tribute and a Motorhead tribute, because, again, there's no reason that just because you're a Motorhead fan, you can't put on a Duran Duran record. To me, if it's good music and you put it on and your ears tell you, you know, you like
it. What's funny about the Duran Duran thing, it's like, I have some friends, I was playing this the other day, it's like, friends that are girls, and they're like hardcore metalheads, man, like goth chicks, just hardcore death metal chicks. They show up at a Duran 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 show, and they're like, oh, woohoo!
Yeah.
You know, they're all let loose, and at the end of the day, they're still girls.
Yeah, there you go.
It's quite interesting.
And then, Bobby, I'd also like to ask you, being the guitar player, when you got into the early Motorhead stuff, were you much of a fan of Fast Eddie Clark? And what did you think of his band Fastway? Did you ever hear anything he did with that after you left Motorhead?
Yeah, I had the first album, and I think I
loved the first two.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was a bummer because they broke up, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Motorhead broke up temporarily, didn't they?
Yeah, I mean, there was about, I think if you see an interview a long time ago with Lemmy, he says he was the only guy in Motorhead for about 4 hours.
Wow.
Yeah, that was bummer. Filthy left, and I guess like later that day, Filthy came back, and then that's when they started looking at Brian Robertson and Lizzie and that kind of thing.
Yeah, and they had the what's his face from Saxon play with him, right? A little bit.
Yeah, that guy right there, Pete Cat is a badass drummer.
drummer, man.
Yeah.
That guy was an amazing drummer.
Yeah, that's Rick Espatron, isn't it?
Yeah.
And if you watch the good show, if you can catch it on YouTube, is Lemmy's birthday show. They're all Brian Robertson's playing.
Yeah.
I guess, yeah, it's really good.
He was so light at that one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, well.
Yeah, they came out with another perfect day right afterward, after Iron Fist, after Eddie Clark quit, and fucking brutal album. I'm not supposed to say punk rock. I'm sorry.
That's all right. It's cool. It's all rock and roll.
Brutal album.
Yeah.
Heavy is, you know, totally heavy. Drumming was, I mean, that's what Filthy pretty much peaked out, I think, on his drumming. And later he got
another perfect day.
Oh man, it's just some great drumming and heavy.
One of their worst selling albums, but one of their best. You know, it's just like AC/DC's "Flick of the Switch" is such an underrated.
Yeah, right. I love that one.
Oh, that's a great album. That's my favorite.
Just show you people know what the hell they like. You know.
Yeah.
I remember my sister used "Back at the Funny Farm" as her English paper.
Right.
No lyrics to that.
Oh, there's so many. I mean, that's got dancing on
your
grave.
You don't do anything on that album, do we?
No, we should.
You should dance on your grave, or I got mine.
Hey, you
grave.
Bastard.
Yeah, Hey, you bastard. You good one, too.
Wow. And so I guess I'd like to now go around and ask each of you guys, like, I guess we can start with you, Scott. I'd like to ask you guys, why did you pick, like, in your case, Scott, the drums as your instrument of choice?
I was 8 or 9 years old. My oldest brother, Guy, was a drummer in his local rock bands. They all sounded like the Eagles and that kind of crap. But, just, you know, he had a drum kit in the house. I banged on a little bit as a kid. And then when I was 10 years old, I got into a marching band with my school. And I stayed in marching band until I was in the high school. And then, you know, discovered the Bay Area thrash scene and the new wave of British heavy metal that all attacked me at once. And, yeah, my life was over after that.
Okay.
Oh, so those are those little marching beats you're throwing in there.
Oh, yeah, it's in there.
And so how about you, Bobby? Why did you choose the guitar? It was... What you know made you go towards a guitar as opposed to being a lead singer or bass player?
When I was growing up, there's one part of my life where we lived, there wasn't really other kids to play with.
Uh-huh.
And so I kind of got into drawing pictures and reading comic books. My uncle one day gave me an acoustic guitar because I always had a radio on, so uh-huh. I kind of started playing that for a while. And then I put it down, and then I took drums like in elementary school for a little bit. And then one day my friend came over to guitar and he started showing me chords like Iron Man and stuff like that, and then went out and bought another guitar.
Wow.
And just totally got into it after that and just stuck with it ever since.
And how about you?
Do it to get late?
Oh, that's heck.
Do you play guitar to get late? Oh,
that's definitely why I wanted to be in a band, for sure.
Hello?
Yeah. And how about you, Glenn? Why did you go more towards the bass?
Well, I was a drummer for a long time, so most of my early life, so that's why I was into Motorhead, because if you were a young drummer in the early 80s, man, you were into, like, you know, Motorhead, Priest, even with heavy drums, you know, and double bass or whatever, and then, I've done bands playing bass and singing and playing guitar and singing, but this one requires bass and singing, so that's why I'm doing it for this one. I'm actually using the guitar stack, I've got an actual old, the 76 Marshall from that belonged to Foghat.
Wow.
The Hunter one. Hella loud. Super loud. I played through that for this band to get that sound, so.
Yeah, and being that this is...
sounds dead on. That's
great.
Hats off to both of you guys as a drummer, man. It's really, you know, you notice when guitar players have good tone, bad tone.
Yeah.
Both these guys nailed the Motorhead sound like dead on. It's unreal.
Well, and let me ask you, Glenn. Do you think the fact that you were a drummer first helps you to lock in with the drummer now? You know, playing the bass.
Yeah, I think drummers can. Drummers can pretty much do anything. I think they can teach themselves other instruments. They can sing. I mean, drummers are incredible people. I think they're look at a lot of guys. Kurt Cobain was a drummer. Steve Tyler, a lot of guys you start on drums because it's all numbers in your head. You visualize a block of numbers, a song. You visualize it as a structure. That's what I have always done from the beginning. But I taught myself guitar, whatever, after learning drums. But drums were my main love. And you think of music and songs, you see them as a structure, as something as it goes along. I do, at least.
Yeah.
The blocks of fours or eights or whatever.
Absolutely.
As like a physical structure, like a building.
building as it goes inside. Each song has a different shape to it.
And let me ask you, Glenn, being that you're also the lead singer in this band, did that take you a while to get used to, you know, hearing your voice and getting used to how it sounded? Because I imagine a lot of your other bands, you were just playing the bass.
Yeah, you know, then you hear a recording and you go, fuck, I sound like crap. Don't drink. Don't drink and you think you sound good. What do you mean?
No, I guess, you know, like you said that, you know, typically in your other bands, you primarily were just the bass player. So when you started singing lead for this, did it take you a while to get used to hearing your, you know, what you sounded like and being able to adjust to that?
You know, most of the bands have always been lead singer. A couple of bands I did just played drums in and was just a lead singer or guitar and sing, but I was pretty much on it most of the time, always lead singing, so I'm used to it. And it's difficult because you're playing, depending on what you're playing,
yeah. You
can't hear yourself. That's just all there is to it. But we've been lucky because the last few shows, we've played some places that have good PA and you can hear yourself. When you can't hear yourself, it's a nightmare.
Wow. Oh, yeah, I never thought about that. Now, let me ask you guys.
Can you sing out of tune? You know, how are you going to sing in tune if you can't hear yourself? Yeah.
Now, let me ask you guys, you know, obviously Motorhead's a, you know, just a trio, but do you think it would, the sound would be that vastly different if you had like a second guitar player?
Probably a lot of
that.
I think it would change the sound, and that's not, I don't know. I mean, that's what Motorhead is. It's three guys playing their asses off, you know?
Well, it's been.
We're doing some of the songs, but just for a clap, I think it's a hassle. I love power trios. That's like so many bands ever, three piece, because you just only got three guys to deal with, and that's it. You have to deal with five. Oh, he's so and so late, can't make the rehearsal, he's out of tune. Two guitars, they have to be perfectly in tune, or it's going to sound like crap. Or it's too loud, you got to turn one guy down, and we have to put some Motorhead there. They say, hey, can you guys play quiet? No, it's freaking Motorhead there. We're going to play quiet?
Yeah. Let me ask you guys. You guys sound like, you know, you get along pretty tight, but I imagine part of that has to do with the fact that you know, you guys live so far apart that when you get together, it makes it that much funner to be around one another.
Yeah,
I've known
the drummer for probably about 3 hours, I think.
Wow. But it's one of those things that, like, if you're a musician, man, you've already got mutual ground, and especially if you're doing, like, a tribute where you love the band you're doing. Again, one more thing you have in common, and if you have a great sense of humor, I mean, immediately with these guys, I mean, you know, I think most musicians that don't take themselves way too seriously and, like, the bus balls a little bit, they're the greatest guys in the world, man. We're always fun, we'll always get along kind of a deal, you know what I mean?
You can tell if the guy's an asshole right when he walks in the room, like, okay, this kid's not going to work or whatever. Johnny just walked in. We had, a week before the show? We had no drummer. Our drummer had quit. And it was like, we're either going to do the gig or just stand out. And he walks in with a roadie, some road cases, and a smile on his face. I love these songs. Got down there, played like, okay, that's great. Let's do the gig. No problem.
Wow, well, that.
Usually it doesn't go that well.
It was great chemistry across the bat, you know, and that's rare. I mean, I do recognize how rare that is, and I do not take that for granted. That's why I just, you know, it was just icing on the cake that these guys were cool dudes.
You better say that.
The old drummer's coming back.
Wow. Anyways, it's been great talking to you guys. I want to thank you for taking time to do this. I really appreciate this, and maybe down the line we could do it again. Give me about an hour or so, and I could send you an MP3 file of an interview, and it'll be going up probably in about a week or so. I'll be sure to let you know the minute it goes up. I'm out of Los Angeles, and I'll send you the link so you can check out the website. We got some other interviews up there.
Oh, so then we might get some gigs down in LA from this thing.
Yeah, maybe.
That would be awesome. I'd love to go down there.
Okay. Well, you guys take.
And for my selfless self promotion, my thrash metal band is playing in LA on February 6th and 7th.
What? Well, you know what? That's what this is all about, and that's what this is all about, and like Bobby and I were discussing earlier, I'm going to be interviewing him separately about his other band, Discordia, and if you other two guys have any other bands you're in, please get in touch with me, and we can help you promote those bands as well.
Awesome, we appreciate it, man. Thanks for taking the time.
Okay, you too. Take care, guys.
Yes, that was awesome.
Okay, bye bye.